this video, we're going to take a look at resistance and what it means. So far, we've seen current, and we talked about that previously, what current was, and we've talked about potential difference. Now we're going to complete the trinity with resistance, and we're going to link it to an equation called Ohm's law. So the key ideas for today are talking about ohmic and non-ohmic resistors, talking about what resistance is and what it depends on, and talking about Ohm's law. So by the end of this lesson, hopefully you can solve problems involving Ohm's law and using the resistivity equation. Resistance, and we use the symbol capital R for resistance, is a measure of the retardation or restriction experienced by charge flowing through an object. We use the symbol of ohms, so we use the Greek letter omega. It kind of makes sense, omega, ohm. And the symbol that we represent it with is capital R, R for resistance. So finally, one that makes sense. Think of resistance in a similar way to when we talked about an electric circuit being a hose. We said that potential difference is kind of like the power or the pressure in the hose pushing it through. The current is how much water is flowing in a unit of time. So how many liters per second, for example, was kind of the current, how many charges per second. The resistance is just how much resistance is there in that hose. So if we squeeze the hose, crimp it, or even just use a smaller hose, there's going to be more resistance. There's more pressure fighting back against that water flow. So a greater resistance in the hose means that less water will flow. And that's the same thing that we see in an electric circuit. A greater resistance in a circuit means there is less current flowing. A good conductor is defined as something with a low resistance. So charges can flow through it really easily because of that low resistivity. On the other hand, an insulator or a very poor conductor has a very high resistance. So it's very difficult for that charge to flow through it. Therefore, we would say it doesn't conduct. Electricity cannot pass through it. This is the resistor color code chart. So resistors, typical resistors look a bit like this. They're a very small, almost like ceramic bulb with a wire sticking out on both sides. And they've got a bunch of colors on them. The colors are actually like a universal code to identify what they are. They're too small to just write on, and that could rub off. So what they do is they mark color bands around them, and we use that to identify the resistor. So how to identify it is we use the first strip to give us the first digit of the number. Then the second one gives us the second digit. So this could be numbers. We could have like 23, or it could just be a zero, as in 20. The third band is then our multiplier. So we could have, in this case, we've got green, which is 5, blue, which is 6. So we've got 56, and then we multiply it by 100, which is the red. So 5600 or 5600 would be the code. So it's a 5600 ohm resistor. Because we're talking thousands, we could go to kilo. So instead of 5,600, we could say 5.6 kilo ohms. So kilo just means times 10 to the 3. And the last little band gives us a tolerance. So the silver says it's 10%. Gold is better at 5%. So this is really just an uncertainty, almost like the quality. Silver is okay. If you have a gold banded resistor, much higher quality. That value that we just said, the 5.6 kilo ohms, is give or take 5%. Have a go at this one. This is a picture of a resistor. Use this code to identify what size, what resistance this resistor would have. So pause the video, have a go at it. Hopefully you've worked it out, and if you did it right, you should find that it's a 10,000 ohm or 10 kilo ohm resistor with a plus or minus 5% resistance. So this approach is really useful. You can just Google this when you're out in the world. You can find a resistor, you can Google this color chart, and you can identify what you're using. Now let's look at Ohm's law. Ohm's law says that the current is directly proportional to the potential difference, providing the temperature of the conductor remains constant. We are going to see why temperature is important in a minute, but basically Ohm's law is just saying that current is directly proportional to potential difference. So we can write it like this. I for current is directly proportional to capital V, potential difference. Ohm's law is actually represented as an equation with one other thing. So this actually combines the trinity of resistance, current, and potential difference. And we get this equation, the V equals IR. This is Ohm's law. We could also rearrange it in a few different ways. Sometimes we might see R equals V on I. We could also have I equals V on R. There's three ways you can write it, but V equals IR is kind of the most common format where we've got V for potential, I for current, R for resistance. And this is quite powerful because in an electric circuit, if we know the voltage and we know the resistance, we can find how much current. If we know the current and we know the voltage, we can find how much resistance is that device providing. So it's a really useful thing to analyze electric circuits. Have a go at these practice questions using Ohm's law. We've got a current flowing through a circuit. We know its potential difference. We want to calculate the resistance. Then we've got a coil of wire with a known resistance. We want to calculate the current if we know the potential. And then the last one, very similar to what we've seen in the previous example, determine the number of electrons passing in half a minute. So it's applying the knowledge we use. So have a go at that. I'll give you 5 minutes.
Let me hear your body talk.
All right, let's take a look. So in the first case, we're using R equals V on I, and we get 51.1 ohms. So that should be 3 sig figs. In the second one, same equation, but I'm rearranging because I want I. So I is equal to V on R, 0.27 amps. And then in the last one, number of electrons, because charge is current times time, I can multiply current is charges per second, remember? So if I multiply it by half a minute, which is 30 seconds, I get 8.1 coulombs. But then number of electrons is the total charge divided by the charge of one electron. So I've had 8.1 coulombs and every electron is the 1.6 times 10 to the negative 19. That gives me 5.1 times 10 to the 19 electrons. So let's talk about ohmic versus non-ohmic resistors. If a resistor obeys Ohm's law, that is that the current and the potential difference are proportional, then we would say it's ohmic. The reason that we define this is because resistance actually changes with temperature. If a circuit or an appliance is cold, it has less resistance. If it's hotter, it has more resistance. So this is a big part of why we want to keep electronics cold. For example, in a computer, there's a lot of technology and research that goes into cooling fans and like CPU coolers, and you can have water coolers and things like that. The whole reason we want to cool them is one, so it doesn't melt, but two, because if it's colder, it has less resistance, which means the circuits can operate better. They can run faster. Often in the real world, conductors are ohmic over a reasonable range of current and potential. So within tolerance, they work as an ohmic, but heat is created with large currents. And it kind of makes sense. If you have a lot of electrons racing through a wire, that generates friction. You still have friction within an electron moving. So if it's moving very, very rapidly, it's going to generate friction, which increases the heat. So therefore, Ohm's law is not going to be followed for all values of current and potential difference in a resistor. So what we're really saying is that a conductor is ohmic if the temperature remains constant in the real world. In general, remember the definition, an ohmic resistor just obeys Ohm's law, so I and V are directly proportional. But in reality, if we can keep the temperature constant, then it will be ohmic. If something does not obey Ohm's law, we say it is non-ohmic. A really common example of that is something like a filament globe or a heat lamp, because the temperature increases over time. At first, it starts off a little bit cold, and then as it gets hotter and hotter and hotter, it gets brighter and brighter, up to a maximum value. So if we graph this, it would look a bit like this. We can see current versus voltage, and you can see it starts off pretty good, but now as the voltage increases, the current is not increasing by a linear amount. The current is increasing by less and less every time because we're losing some due to that resistance created by the heat. Now we're going to look at resistivity and resistance. When charge flows through a conductor, the resistance that we have on it, so the resistance in a piece of wire, resistance in an appliance, etc., it depends on a couple of key factors. Firstly, it depends on the length. The further it has to travel, the more resistance you're going to have. Depends on the area of cross-section. So that's a fancy way of saying how thick is the wire, for example. Depends on the type of material. A metal wire is going to work a lot better than a wooden wire. Depends on the temperature. We just talked about that. It links with Ohm's law. So the higher the temperature, the more resistance. To start off with, let's break down length of material. Resistance is directly proportional to the length of a conductor. So R is directly proportional to capital L. This makes sense because the electrons over a greater distance are going to suffer twice as many collisions. And when we're talking about collisions, we're literally talking about electrons bumping into things. Every time they do that, they lose energy, slows them down. That is the concept of resistance. So if you have to travel further, you're more likely to hit stuff, which means that you're going to lose more and more energy over that distance. For the cross-sectional area, it's inversely proportional to the area and the resistance. And this kind of makes sense because if you have the same number of electrons traveling down a narrow hallway versus a superhighway, there's much less chance of them colliding with each other. Remember, the collisions are the things that are wasting energy, that are causing resistance. So if you have the same number of cars, but a six-lane highway versus one, a lot less collisions, a lot less resistance. The type of the material. This is a property of the material called resistivity. So resistivity, and we use the Greek symbol rho, which we've seen before. We use it for density. But resistivity is just a property of a material. So this is just a given value. It's defined as the resistance of a 1 meter length of wire with an area, so cross-sectional area, of 1 meter squared. That's pretty massive, if you think about it. That's a meter squared diameter, or sorry, cross-sectional area, and 1 meter long. That is a ginormous piece of wire. You can do the math. If we've got a cross-sectional area of 1 meter, what would that be the radius? So that's just reversing the pi r squared. You can work it out. But we would say it's directly proportional. So resistance and resistivity are directly proportional. And lastly, we've got temperature. Temperature, we're going to talk about this next semester, but temperature is just a measure of kinetic energy. So it's actually referring to the kinetic energy of the particle, which in this case is the electron. So how much kinetic energy, how fast those electrons are moving. If we increase the temperature, you're increasing the energy of the electron, which means it's going to collide more often and with more force. I like to use the bumper car analogy. If you've got a room full of bumper cars, everyone's just very slowly crawling around. In the same amount of time, there's going to be a lot less collisions. And when you do collide with something, it's a lot less dramatic. It's just a little bump and off you go. If you crank that up and you plant your foot, everyone is flying around the room. They're smashing into each other much more often and with much more force. So they're losing much more energy as a result of all of those collisions. Therefore, at higher temperature, we lose more energy for those electrons. This is the equation. So if we put it all together, we get R, which is the resistance, is equal to the resistivity of the material times the length of the wire or the thing that it's traveling through, divided by the cross-sectional area of that wire. And you can see all the relationships we talked about. Resistance is directly proportional to resistivity, and it's directly proportional to length. And resistance is inversely proportional to the area. So if the area increases, resistance goes down. So using this information, have a go at these practice questions. So we're calculating resistance, calculating resistivity. Remember, that's a little bit different. And then stating, so this is state. This is using some proportionality here because we're talking state, not calculate. State the new resistance if we decrease the cross-section area by 4. So have a go at that. Okay, let's take a look. First case, we're using resistance equals rho L over A. Area is pi r squared. So they gave us the diameter, so we need to use that in pi r squared. Diameter is 2 times radius. The next one, we're rearranging to find resistivity. The unit for resistivity is ohms per meter. And again, I guess this kind of makes sense because we defined it before as it's the amount of resistance per meter. So it's not per meter, it's ohm meters. So ohms every meter. If the resistance is R, this is using proportionality. So as R is inversely proportional to A, resistance will be 4 times larger if the cross-sectional area decreases by 4. So 4R is the one. Or if you wanted to, using the previous equation, you could say it's 4.4 times 10 to the minus 2. From here, have a go at the workbook questions. So page 79, question 1 to 6, talks about resistance. And page 82, question 1 to 5, talks about resistance and resistivity equations. And I'll see you next lesson.